सच्चे मन के सच्चे, सारी जग की आंख के तारे, ये वो नन्हे फूल है जो भगवान को लगते प्यारे। दिस इज अ वेरी पॉपुलर सॉन्ग, बट समटाइम्स फॉर पेरेंट्स इट कैन बी लाइक अ ई मोमेंट, यू आर सो हैप्पी अबाउट एवरीथिंग, एंड समटाइम्स इट कैन बी आई विश आई हैड माई ओन टाइम। हाउ टू बैलेंस बिटवीन द ई एंड द ऊ, द हैप्पीनेस एंड द सैडनेस, एंड मेक योर प्रोसेस एज अ पेरेंट टू बी फन विथ योर चाइल्ड। टेकिंग यू थ्रू दिस लाइव टॉक टूडे ऑन एफ बी इज डॉक्टर अली ख्वाजा, चेयरमैन एंड फाउंडर ऑफ बंजारा अकेडमी। ओवर टू हिम।
वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग। बाय द वे इट्स सैटरडे मॉर्निंग। What are you people sitting here in front of your phone or your laptop and attending this boring webinar? You should be enjoying with the children, no? Instead of that, you know, you are trying to act so adultish and you are saying, let me find out how I can be a better parent or how I can deal better with children. I think instead of listening to people like me, if you start listening to your child, he or she will teach you a lot of things about how to make parenting fun. Anyway, since you have taken the trouble to come onto this webinar, I have to do justice, right? So I have to make your time worthwhile. Let me see what inputs I can give you. Let us start with understanding this title, why we chose it, Parenting Can Be Fun. I actually believe that parenting is fun. But somewhere along the line, we give up the fun part of it and we take ourselves too seriously. And we start thinking of us as those very, very important adults, the parents or whatever you are. You may be a teacher, counselor, parent. It doesn't matter. When we say parenting, and we're just using that word very generally. You don't necessarily have to be a biological parent. But if you're dealing with children in any context, in any way you're interacting with children, please remember that children can be the greatest stress busters for you, provided you want to make your interactions with them as fun, including even if you're teaching a child, even if you're trying to discipline a child, it can all be done in a fun way. To do that, the first thing that you have to do is stop taking yourself seriously, okay? Forget about the fact that you are whatever your age, 20, 40, 60, 80, whatever your age is. Forget the fact that you are a responsible adult. Forget the fact that you are supposed to be taking care of and giving a good upbringing to this child or something of that sort. Don't take that role too seriously. Even without parenting, children do grow up. There are innumerable children who have not had the privilege of fantastic parents and loving, caring homes and this and that. Even they have managed to grow up into wonderful adults. Some of them have done better than what they would have done if they had their parents hanging around. So while we would like to put in all our efforts to ensure that whoever the children are under our control or under our guidance, we would like to make life better, let us stop presuming that I am the only person who can do it. This is my full-time job, etc., etc. When I ask people, you know, who are you or something like that, sometimes I get these wonderful ladies who say, when I ask you, who are you? They say, I'm a mother of two children. But that is not who you are. It is what you are. You understand the difference? The same thing applies to dealing with children. It is not your identity to be a parent or to be a teacher or to be whatever it is to the child. It is a role that you are playing. And that role can be played by anybody. Remember that. If you are not there, some other adult can take over and give as good an upbringing to the child as you thought you were giving to the child. It's like how, you know, I come across people who sit in positions of authority. They are some manager, director, commissioner, whatever, they have this fancy designation. And they start believing that that designation is them. Whereas it is not. The designation continues indefinitely. You are only transitory. You are only in between, you know, occupying that position for some time. You will move on and somebody else will come over and perhaps do a better job than you can. So the same way as I keep exhorting people, don't take your official title or position too seriously. Don't think that you're the only one who can accomplish this task or keep this team together or whatever it is. The same way as a parent, as a responsible adult, please don't think that it's only you who can do whatever it is. Without you, your child will go astray or something of that sort. The way children have to be dealt with is to start with this understanding that you remember that famous quote of Khalil Gibran that your children are through you, they don't belong to you. You're only a means of having brought the children into this world and perhaps also a means of giving them a good upbringing and allowing them to grow up till they fly out of the nest. But many of us take this role too seriously. And the more you take this role seriously, the more life becomes difficult for you and the less there is effect on the child. Remember that. I do not want anybody to think of parenting as a full-time role. There are wonderful women who decide, I will give up my career for the sake of my child. I am qualified, I am capable, I am experienced, I know that I can go out there in the world, earn a lot of money, make a name for myself, have a career, but I will not do it because I want to take care of the child. Good. Nice for you that you are making such a big sacrifice. And if the finances of the family are taken care of, you can sit back and say, why should I go and earn more money? I'd rather do something more meaningful. But if you are going to be at home, do not become what they are used to refer as helicopter parents. You heard of that term, no? The helicopter keeps hovering over the place, looking down to see what's happening. So we used to say that there are some parents who become helicopter parents. They're all the time somewhere above the child and hovering around. But helicopters used to be huge and they are expensive and all that. Now we have drone parents. A drone is very affordable, few thousands and you can buy yourself a drone and you can be right very close to your child, just few feet above him, and with your webcam you can keep watching whatever the child is doing. So unfortunately, I see a lot of drone parents around the place. And of course, no discourse, no talk can be complete without, you know, how earlier nothing would start off without taking the name of God or invocating Ganesha or something of that sort. Nowadays, no talk, no session, no discussion can be complete without taking the name of the Devi Karuna Amma. So now that Karuna Amma walked into your house and took control over your family, you have decided that you are going to recharge the batteries of your drone, and there you are, a few feet away from the child all the time. This is one word of caution I want to give you. Before I even talk about what are the ways and means to make parenting a joy and how to have wonderful activities with the children and all that, one of the most important things to understand is that while it has been mentioned that you should do social distancing, you're obviously not doing social distancing with the children in your house. In fact, you are becoming closer and closer to them because you're maintaining social distancing outside. And you are also preventing the children from having social distancing or social interactions rather with the people with whom they would love to have. So now when you are stuck physically together, now that you have more and more physical time together, please try to give space. That would be a very, very important precondition before you can convert your interactions into joy. If you are going to be spending 24/7 with your child and be a drone hovering over his head and checking out everything that the child is doing, no way you can make it a joy for the child. No way you can make it a child joy for yourself. And it does not ensure that your child is going to become a more happier and a more fulfilled child. Let me make that absolutely clear, whatever you may think is your capabilities. Just to give you an example, there was this old student of mine who one day walked in and she said, "I just came to say hello." I said, "Glad you came at this time, because if you had come 5 minutes later, I would have been in class. I'm taking a session and I was about to walk into the class. But since you've come, you know, so I could meet you." "Oh, what class?" "I mentioned the topic." "Oh, that's a very fascinating topic. You know, I would love to hear. Can I come and sit?" I said, "Sure, you're part of our Banjara family. Since you've come, come and sit." But she said, "No, I've left my daughter alone at home." "Okay, then you better go home." "No, but I want to attend the talk." "So then you attend the talk." "No, but my daughter is alone." I said, "Please pick up the phone and ask your daughter, do you need me? Is there something for which, you know, you want me to be back immediately or something of that sort? Let her decide." No, it had not even struck her. Anyway, she called up and she gave a long explanation. "You know, I had gone to that mall and I've done that shopping and I bought this that you wanted and I got your dress repaired," and all that long explanation she gave. "And I was on the way home, you know, I came right up to Artinagar and I was about to come. Then I said, let me for 2 minutes drop in at Banjara Academy and say hi to everybody there. And then I was about to just leave when I came to know that there's this very interesting lecture. So, you know, if I can stay back for an hour and if I can do this and that, I hope you don't mind. I hope, you know, you won't feel lonely. I hope it is okay if I stay back. So can I stay back for one more hour and then come?" You know what the daughter said? "Thank you, mommy." Teenage daughter having a chance to stay alone at home without mommy is such a thrill for her. And if that gets extended by one more hour, you know, she was actually happy. As long as the fridge was full of goodies and she had her mobile phone and her music system or whatever else she needs in life, why does she need mommy around? But does mommy understand that? Unfortunately, many mummies and many daddies don't. And when that happens, the joy of parenting is gone. You have to grow with your child. Possibly when your child was 1 year old and you left your child for a few minutes, she would have started crying. When the child was 3 years old, if you wanted to leave the child out away for 1, 2, 3 hours, the child would have started crying. When you were 6 years old and you said that I'm going away for 3 days, the child would have started crying. By the time the child has come to teenage, the child herself will turn around and say, "Mommy, why don't you go for a vacation? Why don't you go and visit grandpa? Why don't you do this? Or why don't you do that? Because the child wants space. So you can give space only if you grow with your child, right? If you get stuck, your child is growing up. 2 years, 4 years, 8 years, 6 years, 14 years. But you are stuck being the parent of a baby. It happens so often, you know, without our realizing it. There was a wonderful joke that, you know, there were the school vans which reached the school at 8:15, 8:20, and 8:30 was the bell for the assembly. So the vans were expected at about 8, 8:05. The school office gets a call from a mother saying that, you know, has route number 13 bus reached the school? They said, "No, ma'am, it's only 8:05. The van normally reaches by 8:20, 8:25 and all that." Okay. By 8:15, there was another call. "Has the bus reached the school?" "No, ma'am, it's not yet time. It's just 8:15. No, another 5, 10 minutes, the bus should be there." 8:20, third call. "Has the bus reached?" "Ma'am, the bus will be coming any minute now, but why are you getting so anxious? Which class is your child?" The person in the office thought maybe small child and she's worried whether he's crying or something of that sort. "Which class is your child?" And the mother says, "No, my son is the bus driver." Now, this may be a joke, but actually this is what we do. We don't grow with the child. We don't let go of the child, we take it so seriously and we make life miserable for ourselves as well as for the children. Now, before again going into the fun part of it, let's also look at the unfun part of it. What makes parenting stressful? What makes interaction with children a little difficult and all that? It is primarily what we refer to as discipline issues, right? We ask our child to do something, the child refuses. Or the child does something in a wrong manner. And that is what creates conflict. But there again, I want to caution you, it is primarily because we take things too seriously. Please start understanding the difference between desirable behavior and compulsory behavior. Okay. There are certain things which are compulsory, which you cannot make an exception. If the child is taking things from somebody else's bag in the school, if the child is taking away money from your cupboard or your purse without your permission, these you can say are absolutely compulsory. There is no way that I can allow it. I'm going to be very strict and I'm not going to allow my child to do that. But believe me, for one odd strict behavior like that, there are so many others where it is only undesirable behavior. The type of dress that your child wears, the type of hairstyle that your child wants, he wants to spike up his hair or something of that sort. The words or the slangs that your child uses. You have this highly respected old uncle who is anyway very irritating, but because of his age, you have been, it's been drilled into you that you have to give respect to him or something of that sort. And you say that, you know that so and so uncle is coming, you better behave properly. And your child says, oh, that old dude is coming back again. What do you mean, old dude? That's not the way you talk to your relatives and elders and something. Now, what makes you think that dude is not a good word to use? Is it an obscene word? Is it a gali? No. It is just something which you have never used earlier in your life. But children are using it every day. So you can't, you know, slowly try and tell the child, since I'm not used to it. We don't normally refer to our elders as dude and things of that sort. So it sort of unnerves me, you know, when you say that. Can we avoid that? Can we use some other word? Give options, alternatives. Say, is that uncle coming again? Is that papa coming again, or whatever, that gentleman coming again or something. Can we use such words, at least in our conversation? Otherwise, I get shaken up. There's no harm in doing that. But scolding a child for doing things like that, that is what I'm concerned about. If we take our role too seriously and we say that I want everything to be as per my will and as per what I believe in and as per my attitudes and all that, you are living in the past. Even a simple thing like respect. I am a strong believer that you have to command respect and not demand respect. Similarly, trying to relive your life through them. That's another thing which really pains me. I wanted to learn a musical instrument. My parents didn't allow me and they forced me to study and I could do this. So now I'm going to make sure that my child becomes a musician. That's not the right thing, no? That's my life. If even now at this age I want to become a musician, yes, I have a right to do it. But sometimes what we do is, no, I'm too old for it now. People will laugh if I start learning that instrument or start singing or something. I can't do it. But I think my child will do very well, so I will like to do it. I wanted to be a doctor, but at that time my parents said, no, it costs a lot of money and you have to study for years and years. We want to get you married off and things like that. They didn't allow me to be a doctor. So now I, this great, very liberal and progressive parent, I want my daughter to become a doctor. But your daughter does not want to become a doctor. She wants to go into fashion modeling, or she wants to go into Formula One car race driving or whatever it may be, can we not have an open discussion and come to a consensus instead of trying to impose these type of things into you? Similarly, if you want to enjoy being with your child, please, as I said, grow with your child. Give your child more and more autonomy as the child grows. I keep always recollecting that little video of the eagle. The eagle builds its nest 500 feet, 1000 feet above, and on a ledge, and the eggs are laid, the eggs are hatched. The eagle takes care of those little eaglets, keeps feeding them, and one fine day she looks at the children and says, "Today is the day." And she just pushes the eaglet out of the nest, 1000 feet above the ground. The first time in her life that eaglet is out there in the open, falling. And before you know it, she spreads out her wings and starts flapping. And before she hits the ground, she starts flying and then she starts soaring. The mother eagle knows that it is time to push out the child. But mother human beings, the so-called very wise and intellectual people, we don't know when it is time to start pushing the child forward to become more and more autonomous. If you do that, then you reduce your own responsibility, you reduce your own work, and you can spend more and more time enjoying with your child. Then there's another thing which I always emphasize. Please pardon me for repeating it. Parenting is not a popularity contest. For whom are you doing parenting? For your child. For your child's betterment, for your child's welfare. Not to show to your neighbors that my child is such a good painter or such a good artist or whatever it is. Not to show off to your in-laws that my child is so well behaved. Not to impress people in the mall that my child listens to whatever instructions I give him and he doesn't throw tantrums. Never do that. Limit your parenting to the good of the child. Do not participate in popularity contests for parents. Let everybody do whatever they want. And then one more thing before we go on to the actual tips and pointers on having fun with children, that is, do remember that parenting is not one single word. It is a combination of fathering and mothering. 10 fathers cannot give a child what one mother can give, and 10 mothers cannot give a child what one father can give. Now, there are certain roles, there are certain things that we are doing, but at the same time, I'm a little apprehensive that we have started pampering our children in this era too much. Particularly in the last 6 months, everything has gone electronic, everything has gone on the screen. And it appears as though there is no life beyond the mobile or the laptop. Life has got constrained to that 6 inches screen. So much so that people in the family are even forgetting how to talk and emote and communicate. There's this lovely little cartoon that I saw the other day about how children have become so dependent on the screen to communicate rather than talking even to their own parents. Just have a look at this cartoon. Mom has left her phone here. We'll have to walk to the kitchen to tell her to get us dinner. You think that's a joke? No, it isn't. It's a very sad state of affairs. It is a reality which, if it has not hit your family, sometime or the other, it will hit. If you have not reached that point, you are walking in that direction. So start with talking verbally, openly, one-to-one, face-to-face, not through the phones and not through any other electronic gadgets. The other thing is, this is something which I've always been talking about. Can you become childlike? There's a world's difference between being childlike and childish. I'm not asking you to become childish. In fact, a lot of adults behave in a childish manner without even realizing it. When they become envious, my neighbor has bought a big car, so I also want to buy. That is childishness. It's not competing, it's not going up the social ladder or something. It is downright childishness to say, even though I have a very good car, it's giving me perfect service, I'm enjoying using that car, but because my neighbor has got a bigger car, so I am going to buy a bigger car. I'm just giving that as an example. Whereas, childlike is that sweet innocence which children have and which we can learn and which we can follow. We can do that if we are willing to think of those type of things. Otherwise, we land up in a situation, even if you have a small baby, where you will become so technology dependent that you won't know how to handle it. See this cartoon of a small baby and what happens in some of the houses. Mom is telling dad, can you play with him for a while? His battery died. The kid is screaming away to glory because the screen has gone dead and he does not know that there is a world outside that. And the mother has to tell the father that, can you please talk to him for a while? Now, can dad become childlike and say, okay, I'll also get down on all fours and I'll start crawling around with you. Can we take that rattle and see what type of noises that rattle makes? Can we go into the balcony and watch those squirrels and talk to them or something of that sort? That is what is needed, and that is what will ensure that your parenting will become a joy. Many of these things are to be taken very with a lot of understanding. When I talk about being a childlike, even accepting when you made a mistake. I lose my temper for a very small thing and I scream at my child. And then I realize that what I've done is wrong. But do I tell that to the child? No, I don't. All it needs is to become childlike, like how a child will come after some time and say, Daddy, I'm sorry, I did that, I won't do it again. That is childlike. Innocence, straightforwardness. I know Daddy is going to punish me, but still let me get over with it. Daddy is the all-knowing and everything, so let me go back and say sorry. Why can't we do the same? These are some of the very simple examples that we can follow if we want to do these things. Listen to your child. That is something which I can keep on and on and on emphasizing upon. Don't give the child any facilities which you need to take back. It's better to argue it out and have the child throwing tantrums or whatever it is right now and get him used to it and then enjoy. The most important thing in this is children need options and alternatives. You can really enjoy with a child if you give alternatives and options to the child instead of only giving instructions. Now, if I am childlike, if I want to go down to that level, what do children do? You watch children, if 3-4 of them are there, they will brainstorm. They do it much better than what people do in board meetings. Hey, you got a bat? No, you don't have. You got a ball? Shall we go there? No, that old uncle will scream if we play there. Why don't we move this side? How do we do that? They work out things so well. Why can't you practice the same thing with your child? Let's see how very fun and very interesting life becomes when you start doing that. So with that, let me just take a quick break. Seema will give you one or two quick points on what we are doing towards this concept of making child's life better and making our life better as children. And then we'll have an open house as always. The chat box is open. Start typing in your questions. We'll see how many of your questions we can deal with today itself.
Hello, all parents, teachers, and everybody else who works with children. So here in Banjara, we do a lot of activities. Of course, we have a Gurukul, an unconventional school where we work with children. We have a fantastic team led by Sonal. That happens. And also we have a program called CCAD, Certificate in Child and Adolescent Development. So that is something we used to have it here in our classroom sessions, but this year we have decided to go online. And on 7th of December, we are starting our online certification in child and adolescent development. If you really want to understand children better, so as a parent, as a teacher, as anybody who's associated with children, you know, you can take up this online course. So it will happen every Mondays from 10:30 to 12:30. We will have go on G Suite or you know, one of these platforms where our counselors are, you know, child counselors and psychologists and many eminent you know, people working with children will come, and they will conduct the class. I'll just tell you some of the topics that will be covered there. So it will be all the aspects of, you know, physical, emotional, social, cognitive, language skills, everything to do with children. Also the different parenting styles, discipline issues, life skills, the most important skills that every child should have to become a responsible you know, adult. And of course we have dyslexia, slow learners, how do you identify different you know, things in children, emotional disturbances, stress management in children, and also the role of grandparents, and several other things like study techniques or career guidance. So everything that you would like to know you know, about children and know children better. So with that, I, and if you want to get in you know, more information, please contact our office, or you can text me, and we'll be glad to explain the whole 4-month online program. So back to Dr. Ali.
How often do you verbally say, "I love you," to your child? And do you do it in your mother tongue or the language that you generally use at home? It's a poser, it's a question to you. I'm not passing judgment on you. I'm just saying I want you to think. Because a child needs to be told that he or she is loved by parents. The bond becomes very strong. After that, if there are issues, there are discipline matters, you can scold the child. The child will not feel bad, because you are connecting to the child and you are expressing love. Try to go back into the time when you had first fallen in love. Whether it was before marriage or after marriage or in marriage, you fall in love after you get married, right? Whatever it is. The point is, didn't life become so much more enjoyable when you were expressing love to each other? Now that need not stop, neither between the parents nor with the child. And it has to extend to the child. That is very, very important. The more you can tell your child that I love you verbally. The second thing which makes the bond very strong and enjoyable is this wonderful sensation of touch. Please use touch as much as possible and continue to use it as your child grows up. Do not start withdrawing from your child. Nobody has asked you to maintain 6 feet social distance from your child. You can remain 6 micro millimeters away from the child. But life becomes very interesting if spontaneously the whole family learns how to hold hands, how to pat each other, how to put an arm around the shoulder, how to hug, how to lie down in somebody's lap. These are all very small, very simple things. Learn to have as many activities as possible which are away from the screen. It is not difficult, I can tell you. Every now and then I come across parents who say, my child refuses to let go of the smartphone and is all the time onto that and all. The reason for that is because you have not given sufficient alternatives. An alternative that should be interesting. You can't just say, you know, switch off your mobile phone and open your textbook and start reading. No, that's not an option. Academics is on one side, reading, studies, classes, Zoom classes, whatever it is there on one side. But leisure has to be there, and will you participate? That's very important. Do you have options where you show you have, we all know, and I'm repeating again, that role modeling is one of the most important aspects of being a good parent or a good adult. So am I participating in that activity instead of just telling the child that, you know, switch off the phone and go and do this. If we can learn to say, why don't we do this? Try it out. One odd thing, the child will say, no, that's too boring, I don't want to do. Don't get upset and don't force it on your child. Move on to something else. That is how step by step we need to go into the thing. So are we having any questions in the chat box? I don't see anything.
Right.
If there is something, then tell me. Otherwise, I have one or two more interesting points.
Okay. Uma says that we will have to be with them like a child companion to make them learn things, play and learn method, make them more excited rather than making them sit and learn as it is done in school.
Wonderful, Uma. I could not have put it in a better manner. You have just said exactly what I believe in.
Right. So, yeah, they're still, I think, listening to you. So if you have something else, you can add.
You know, the husband of Queen Elizabeth, when he went with the Queen to USA, the Queen was busy meeting up with the President and holding diplomatic talks and this and that. And this person, the husband, you know, normally it is a vice role of the VVIP, but here the gender role changes. So the Duke, you know, was asked to visit some orphanage or go and talk to some people or have some social events and this and that. And at the end of it, when the media asked him, what did you feel about the American family and the American, you know, way of life and all that? He made a wonderful statement. He said, the thing that impresses me most about America is the way parents obey their children. Don't let that happen. Today, you try to impose yourself on your child. The day is not far off when your child grows up and gets into this ping pong battle and wants to impose himself on you. Raji is asking, how do I deal with sibling rivalries? I have two grown-up daughters, but still I see the rivalry. Okay. I want to congratulate Raji for two things. One is for having two children instead of one. That itself is getting more and more extinct, because then a child will not have a sibling, so there will be no sibling rivalry left. So the plus point is that your children have a sibling to have rivalry with and to fight with. The answer to that is very simple. It's amazingly simple. Only two rules you have to set. Number one, you tell the children that if I see either of you hurt, physically hurt, then the other one is going to get punished, and define the punishment in advance. I not listen even if you give excuses saying, no, she used bad words or she did this to me, she did that. If I see either one of you physically hurt in any way, the other person is going to get this punishment. Define it. First rule. The second rule is, whatever you tell your sister, you are not going to use derogatory statements. You can criticize her on her actions. You can criticize her on anything else, but you're not going to put down your sister. Let's say she is very short, so you're not going to start calling her shorty. If she is wearing specs, you're not going to say four eyes or something. You're not going to hit on the individuality. If you follow these rules, I am really happy that you have rivalries, you have competition, you have fights. Go ahead and enjoy your fights as much as you want. And finally, the most important thing, the moment you hear them raising their voices or quarreling or criticizing each other, just get away from there. Do not be party to it. Because sibling rivalry is not against the sibling. Sibling rivalry is to gain attention from the parent. If the parent refuses to give attention, go off into the bathroom and have a nice leisurely bath. Get out from the house, go to your neighbor's place and sit and have a nice chat with her and come back after half an hour. Go to the shop and finish off your purchases. But if you get away from the children, they realize that there's no point in fighting. Very simple rules, but they actually work. Vikas says, how does conditioning in childhood affect parenting in later life? Excellent question, because that is very, very important. Without realizing, we try to do things which our parents did, or in some cases, do exactly the reverse of what our parents did. So sometimes we say, my father was very strict and he had imposed certain rules, so I am going to impose the same rules on my children. See, he brought up 4 children and they grew up so well and they have, you know, become such achievers and all that because of my father's discipline. But your father disciplined you 30 years back. The world has completely changed in this one generation. You can't use your techniques of your father. Similarly, there are those who say, my father was so stingy, he wouldn't even give us 50 paisa for an ice cream at that time. Today, if my child asks for 500 rupees for a pizza, I'm going to give it to him because after all, who am I earning for? So don't reverse it by 180 degrees and do things just because your father never gave you 50 paisa. These are things which we don't realize subconsciously. We have to become aware of how our parenting was done and to keep away from that. And as I told you, parenting is not a popularity contest. You do it to in the welfare of today's child, who is a 21st century child. Gurumurthy says, I personally feel that a child is more likely to follow us than listen to us. Absolutely, 100% right. So it's important that we behave in the way that we expect of our child. Yes, that's exactly what we talk about as role modeling, right? What sort of a role model are you? You're talking on the phone to some client or some colleague and you blatantly tell lies. And you tell your child you should never tell lies. You scream at somebody on the phone or while talking or something of that sort and you tell your child you can't raise up your voice, you can't shout like that. So that's exactly like Gurumurthy said, we cannot, you know, expect the child to listen to us only because we keep giving sermons and this and that. We have to be good role models. Shakuntala says, as a girl child grows, preteen, at times she feels uncomfortable with the father touching and hugging, but the father loves cuddling and playing, thinks her to be a child. This at times leads to struggle between them. Let the mother talk to the child and ask, why do you feel this way? The preteen is becoming conscious of her body, of her sexuality. And she is also conscious of the fact that daddy is a man, whereas mommy is a woman. So girls, women, my gender, I can play around, I can touch, I can be as close. But it has been drilled into me, no, don't allow any boy to touch you. Don't go too close to boys. Don't do these. Don't do that. Now, in the child's innocent mind, daddy is also a grown-up boy. So you have to undo that. If that has somewhere drilled into the child, you have to say, daddy is daddy. It's nothing to do with the gender. When daddy loves you, enjoy his touch. Enjoy the warmth. Enjoy being close to him. You will not get that later in life, perhaps. Slowly, do it very gently and slowly. Maybe even demonstrate, like I'm just responding to Gurumurthy, that you have to be a role model. Does daddy hug mommy in front of the child? And does mommy say, it feels so nice at the end of the day when you come back and give me a hug, you know, I feel so warm. Or I want to give you a hug before you leave for office so that, you know, I want to leave you in a nice, comfortable and a positive feeling. The moment the child starts seeing that, the child becomes a little more positive. Even then, if the child is taking her own time, go slow and easy. Do little things. Maybe just, you know, give a pat to the child at times. Then slowly start, you know, putting your child on that, hand on your child's shoulder and leaving it there for a few seconds. Like that, get her accustomed to it. But this is the right time to do it before she goes into the teenage and before she starts becoming more and more self-conscious. Rekha says, how to balance being disciplined and fun with our child? Why are we presuming that discipline cannot be fun? Why can't I tell the child, okay, when you do this thing which is not to be done, I have to punish you, right? Now, what is the punishment? The punishment could be, after dinner, you have to come into the kitchen and help me wash the dishes. Now, the moment the child comes, you start enjoying washing the dishes. Make it into a game. Say, let me see if I can scrub this plate faster than you or something like that. Let me see how many I can do and how many you can do. Maybe even take a plate and a spoon and play some music by tapping the spoon on the plate. So a lot of discipline can actually be made into fun. They are not exclusive to each other. Usha says, it has become a challenge to keep my kid away from adult contents even after explaining why they are not ready, which comes in between as ads on any electronic media. What else can be done? Firstly, minimize electronic media. I've been saying that constantly and I will keep saying that. Even if the whole world turns to electronic media, I will continue to exhort and request all of you, minimize electronic media. Show the child that there is a world outside the screen. The second thing is, despite all that, as you rightly said, the so-called adult content comes in. Instead of just saying no, instead of policing, instead of telling your child to stop, discuss it. What do you like about it? Why do you feel like watching it? What is different between this and that? What is the difference between watching, let's say, a family drama and watching an adult movie or something of that sort? And then explain in very simple manners like we do. Today, because you are a child, you can at best get a bicycle. Only when you cross 18, you can get a motorcycle. So everything has its own age. Today, enjoy your bicycle and learn your bicycling so well, your balancing, this, that. So that tomorrow when you become eligible to have a motorcycle, you will be an expert in handling that motorcycle. That's how you take the child ahead. Anupama says, how to be aware teenagers about substance abuse. Most teenagers have the curiosity to explore. And I don't think we should keep them away. If a child has this thing that, what is a cigarette? What's so great about it? Why does Rajnikant do all these gimmicks with the cigarettes and people get so thrilled and they start cheering him in the cinema theater? So there has to be something good about it. Now, if the child goes into that curiosity thing, don't panic. Out of 10 children who experiment with any of these substances, one or two become addicts, 8 or 9 just give up after some time. Or they're very casual about it. One fine day there's a party or something, that time they will do it, other times they will not do it. So as far as that is concerned, talk. When you smoked that cigarette, what happened? Did you get any thrill? Did you enjoy it? Similarly, company. Do you have friends who are forcing you to smoke cigarettes or whatever, drink beer or whatever it is? If so, why do you feel that they should force you? They should respect you, isn't it? If there is a friend who's teasing you and going on saying, hey, you're a sissy, you can't do this, there's something wrong with that child. Why does that child want to impose? Because somewhere the child is not sure whether this is whether he or she is doing a wrong thing and therefore is trying to get your support into it. Tease that child. It is only the lonely children, the children with low self-esteem, children who feel unloved, they are the ones who get into substance addiction. Sarika says, how do we inculcate desirable qualities in our children without being too irritable or matron-like to our... You have answered your question. Do not be irritable. Do not be matron-like. If you are in an irritable mood, don't discuss serious matters with the child. In fact, tell the child, you know, I just had a talk with so-and-so, so-and-so, and that person has irritated me so much, I'm in a bad mood. Can you observe me and see how irritable I am? You can time me and see for how long I remain irritable. But right now, I'm going to be grouchy. I am very angry. I'm very upset with this. And I'm going to go on grumbling and all over the place. Even that can become fun. Even that can become a game. And the child notices and says, you know, Ma, this time you were grouchy for 17 minutes. Last time you were grouchy for only 12 minutes. So your time is increasing. Or vice versa, or whatever it is. Once that is over, then you make up with the child and say, okay, now I'm in a good mood. Now let's talk about discipline or these or whatever are the serious issues. Reena says, how do you work on communication skills with adult boys who don't follow in keeping in touch? Why is it that the adult boy is not keeping in touch? Because he finds there's nothing to talk. And if he talks to his parent, the parents will start asking, what time do you reach home? Are you eating properly? What sort of meals are you having? You are smoking cigarettes. I hope you have stopped. That's not the way to communicate with the child, no? Make the child talk about his feelings. He's grown up. He's an adult. He's independent. Ask him, what do you enjoy doing? What are you liking? What are you doing? What is it that is upsetting you? Focus only on those issues. The child himself will come forward and say, you know, I have these friends who force me to do this. I don't like it. It is possible. We may not realize it, but you can build back. It's a little difficult because the child is already an adult, but it's not impossible. And this is a lesson for all those of you who have smaller children, that don't let that situation happen when your child grows up and then doesn't even want to communicate with you. Today, when your child is small, you have all the opportunities to build a strong bond of communication with them. Sunita says, my son is 7 years old and he has become asking a lot of questions about physical appearances, male and female body parts. How do I help him without giving too much or too less information? There are very good, simple books on sex education, which are age specific. You can pick up one of those, which is applicable. Now, here I would like to caution you, don't go by the chronological age, go by the mental age. There are 7 year olds who think like 10 year olds. There are 7 year olds who think like 7 year olds. And there are 7 year olds who think like 5 year olds. So go by the mental age of the child, what the child already knows, what the child has already explored, and start giving more and more information on that. And when the child has read that, ask questions, open-ended questions. What did you like in that book? What did you learn? What is still confusing you? What are the other answers that you want? Make him ask questions. If you can answer simply in basic words, go ahead and do it. If for some reason you find that you are getting stuck, ask for time. Consult somebody and say, for this child, what would be the right answer on this question? And then go back and answer his questions. Shirin says, if your child is not doing something which one feels is not right with his child, as a grandparent, should one point it out or is it interference? Not at all, Shirin. I think it is your responsibility and it is your privilege as a grandparent to point it out. But when I say point it out, how do we point it out? Not like an accusation. What are you doing with this child? Why are you doing this? No. I want to sit and discuss this with you. When I was with you that particular day or last Sunday, I was sitting and observing you and your child. I saw that this is the way you both were interacting with each other. So you're taking the pressure off your child, okay? You're just saying how both of you were interacting with each other. And there I felt one thing very significantly, that perhaps instead of raising your voice and saying this, or instead of, you know, stopping him from doing that, or instead of being so liberal that you are allowing your child to do this, it would be better if you do it in a different way. And then ask after some time, how did it go? Do you feel that change helps? Can I be of any help to you? Can I talk to your child, that is my grandchild, and try and bring about some change in him? It should be a team effort. Children who have their grandparents around are very, very lucky. And you should utilize that thing of having more than just mommy and daddy in the house. Noor says, father and mother both will be loving children, but because of the differences between them, one of the parent always blames the other parent in front of the children, and this makes child misbehave with the parents. Absolutely right, No, that is something that has to be drilled. I don't know how we will convince that other parent who is putting down, because he or she is not only doing harm to the child and to the other parent, that is the spouse, but also to himself. The child will learn to disrespect you because you have been, you know, putting down your spouse in front of the child. No child wants to take sides. No child wants to, you know, pass judgment. Is my mother right or is my father right? And those sort of things. Venkatesh says, we have a single child, and since our son spends most of the time at home, he looks forward to playing with me and treats me like one of his friends. Excellent. It's a lot of fun, and parents must make time for bonding. 100% right, Venkatesh. You are a very good inspiration to others. However busy you are, whatever your work demands and other responsibilities are there, if you can take out exclusive time, not necessarily along with your wife or your mother or whoever else is there at home, but one-to-one with the child. And if you have more than one child, thankfully, then some time with child A, some time with child B, exclusively to show that child that you are directly important to me and I love connecting with you on a one-to-one basis. Uma says, we'll have to be with them like a child companion to make them learn things. Play and learn method makes them more exciting, rather making them sit and learn as it is done in school. 100% right, Uma. That is what I believe in. Except with one rider, if the child misbehaves, then you stop being a friend. That's the time when you cool off, back off, you know, have a serious demeanor on your face, stop being a friend and say, no, this is what I don't like. I can't enjoy myself because you are doing this, this, this. Give time out to the child and come back and again be a friend and start off. Rina says, we as parents have to only train up our child in the way he or she has to go when they grow up, and they will not depart from it as though as through the 3 M's model. Manage and memories, as they are gifts from God, which we have to return back to them with thanks. Yes, very well said, very thought-provoking. And we need to put this into practice. And with that, we are coming almost to the end of the time. As you know, all Banjara events start on time and end on time. So just a quick summing up. I come back to the most important point, become childlike. Start cracking jokes at your own expense. Sense of humor is being able to take yourself lightly, to be able to take jokes on yourself, to be able to actually crack jokes on yourself. Give yourself funny nicknames and ask your child, how do you enjoy that? Do some mimicry, you know, and ask your child to mimic you. How does daddy behave when he is very angry or grouchy and things of that sort? Do all these sort of little, you know, role plays. Talk in a very light-hearted manner about outsiders if there is some who, you know, is the child doesn't like or something. Play along with the child. It is not as difficult as we think it is. And just to see what has happened now in the communication, just have a look at this little funny cartoon about how we have stopped communicating with children. Say something, the mother is saying, I've forgotten what you sound like. I'm only communicating with you through screens. We are not sitting in front of each other and directly talking to each other. That is where the body language comes in, the tone comes in, the demeanor. So many things that we learn from each other which help us to bond together. And to do that, I have one last slide. Have a look at that, which you should take very seriously. The mother who is saying it is right because I say so. Remember that your child now has a wonderful teacher, come mother, come whatever you want to call it, mentor, counselor, and that is our Google auntie. Do not try to compete. Take it easy, relax. You also go and ask Google auntie what you should do. Maybe she'll help you with that. And we are always there to help you in whatever little way. We can't be with you 24/7 like Google auntie, but as far as possible, we are there with you. We will be there with you whenever you have any need or something. These are just 1 hour webinars which we have once in a week, but otherwise also, please feel free to get in touch if we can be of any use. Let's all put together our thoughts, our ideas, our actions to create a better generation in the coming years, so that civilization, our country, our society, and the whole world turns out to be better as we grow too old and the children take over the world. Have a wonderful time. Thank you all for listening. Have a wonderful weekend. Jai Hind.
Thank you all for joining us today. Wishing you all a very nice, happy, and long weekend and festival times.